What is happening, Startup Nation? How is everybody this afternoon, evening, or morning? I guess it depends on really when you're listening. So we are back with another episode of the Private Practice Startup Podcast, and it is December here.
Yes, I don't know how it's December. This year has flown by like no other.
You just said that, crazy. And I got anxious.
You got anxious?
I got anxious. Like, I need more time to finish my goals for this year. I've accomplished a lot. So we are super excited to have you guys joining us today. And even though we are taking a break from dishing out new content on our podcast, we still are recording. So you guys will hear this in probably January, February. And today we have Nicole ready. Let's see if I can get it right. Liloia. Did I do it, Nicole?
Great work.
All right. Fantastic.
I'll send you a gold star.
Yes. And she's joining us all the way from New Jersey, where she's probably going to get some snow this weekend. Nice and cold.
And I said, thank God her and not us.
We'll have a white Christmas here, but we'll have a sandy white Christmas,
at
the beach. Yes.
That's way better than that. So Nicole's going to join us today, and we're going to talk about how to scale your private practice with multiple income streams, which is always one of my favorite topics to talk about, is more money. But before we do all of that, we just wanted to say we hope last week that you checked out our podcast with Amanda Patterson, who is our friend and colleague here in South Florida. And she talked about business plan, and she had a really cool download. I think it was like a 5 second or 5 minute create your business plan thing. So you're definitely going to want to check that out if you haven't already. And you know what? If you're a loyal listener, we really appreciate you joining us as always. And if you're brand new to us, we wanted to officially welcome you to Startup Nation. So welcome.
Yes. Welcome everybody. We're excited to have you a part of our community.
Yep. And we have a special gift for you that you can head over to privatepracticestartup.com, head over to our resources tab and download the A to Z cheat sheet, the essentials for building and growing a dream practice, and then hop over to Facebook and join us in our group so we can like hang out.
Yes.
Very cool. So we wanted to thank our sponsor today.
Yeah, before we get started, we want to take a quick moment to thank Therapy Notes. They are our sponsor for this episode, and we actually had the opportunity to interview Brad Pliner. He is the CEO of Therapy Notes, and we did a podcast interview with him, so we got the inside scoop about what it was like to use their platform. They gave us a tour of their platform, and it's a practice management system. So it can really help with making your practice management a lot more efficient. It's pretty extensive. They do a lot with having HIPAA compliant notes and all sorts of really cool stuff. So if you want to check out our episode that we did with Brad Pliner, that's episode 54 on using an EMR, EHR, it's kind of termed both ways in our industry, for your practice. So make sure to check that out. Visit our resources page at privatepracticestartup.com, and you will see a link for your 10% off and a free trial for a month, right?
Yep. So free trial for a month, 10% off a year if you decide to join up with Therapy Notes. So how about we get started talking about money?
Yes. How to scale your private practice with multiple income streams.
So Nicole, before we jump into all of that, how in the world did you get started into the therapy world?
My background is as a social worker. So in college, I had started out as a finance major, and then I made the switch to psychology, and I knew I wanted to have a private practice one day. And, social work seemed like an easier way to do that, at least, in the New Jersey area. It's a really nice, we have really great programs here. I got my master's at Columbia in the city. So we have lots of great opportunities to get licensed as a social worker and, you know, work in some agencies and get that experience, and then you can start your own practice.
What made you go from finance to psychology?
You know, I think that I was having, my family had some experience with mental health issues and depression and things like that. So I really felt like I wanted to be doing that work to help other people solve their problems and get over their struggles with depression, anxiety, and other mental health issues. So that's kind of how I made the switch. I also took a macroeconomics course, which I hated and was like, oh gosh, no. No more econ. What major does not involve that?
Gotcha. And I was reading a little bit of your bio, and I think we have a similar story about being a nonprofit. I was actually in the nonprofit world for 11 years, not 11 months, 11 years. Mm-hmm. But I quickly moved into management because I just didn't want to do the in-home at 8 p.m., 9 p.m. at night. And it was just very taxing. But I learned a lot, especially being in management. So a lot about, like, you know, risk management stuff, contracts, auditing. So all of the other important things that we need to know as a therapist, and especially for running a business.
Yeah. And I think that's really the case, is that, you know, you can really get stuck in the agencies without much growth. If you, like, I never wanted to be a manager. I never wanted to kind of do that side of things. So they're really, as a clinician, you're kind of limited in terms of what you're doing. And there's not really much opportunity, I felt, to gain leadership skills, at least in the agency that I was in.
Gotcha. Very cool.
So tell us a little bit about how you transitioned from being a social worker in private practice into the industry that you're in now with working with private practitioners.
Yeah, so I actually discovered coaching early on when I had started my private practice. And I discovered coaching when I was looking at therapist websites and found a lot of coaches' websites. And I was really intrigued by it because I felt that there was a lot of flexibility. And I actually had, earlier when I left my job in the nonprofit role, I had taken time off to travel and volunteer in South America. So I knew that I liked flexibility. I knew that I liked having the opportunity to travel and not be at a 9-to-5 all the time or in that kind of situation. And I realized with the private practice that I had kind of recreated a 9-to-5 for myself. And I just didn't really do well with, like, having the same schedule, having the same everything every day. It just doesn't work well for my personality or my attention styles. So I quickly added in coaching, had the practice part-time and added in coaching because I felt that it was an opportunity to, you know, just try something different and have a little bit more flexibility. I liked the idea of problem solving and being more problem solving for other people. So it was really just one of those switches that it kind of just happened naturally. And I had my practice and was doing both. And then suddenly, you know, more health professionals were just coming to me for help with their business. And that was awesome because I loved it. And I actually feel it connects back to my start as a finance major. Like, I feel like I've come full circle and kind of combined everything into the ideal job because I love helping people be more profitable. I just love helping them really get out of their own way and think bigger, dream bigger. And I feel, in general, women entrepreneurs, and especially I think women therapists and, you know, social workers and counselors are really hard on themselves and really rigid. And I think it just is coming from, you know, where we usually start out working in the nonprofit world. And it's, you know, there's a lot of, like, you're never going to make money. And I think we're getting that message. At least I got that message as a social worker, even really in my graduate program.
Yeah. And we hear that all the time. And I remember when I worked in community mental health, one of the supervisors there, I think as a manager, I was always about personal growth and, like, we got to do more and team building and things like that. And one of the managers was like, well, I mean, the reward is their paycheck. And I was thinking to myself, like, do you even know how much these people make? Like, no, it's not. Like, it was, like, so devastating. And you're right. We've been programmed with those, you know, you can't make money in this field. And it's just really so untrue. And then as we tap into your topic today and talking about multiple streams of income and really how to tap into already doing what you do on a larger scale to diversify and make more income is really awesome. So before we jump into that, it was funny because I was just looking down at your bio and I noticed that you like apothic wine. Did you try the Inferno? The one with the barrel age whiskey.
Oh my gosh, no, I've not tried that for now. I'm a Crush fan.
Ah, okay. Kate's like a super wino, so she probably doesn't drink a pop.
I love a pop-ick.
I know what it is.
I actually did a whole breakdown of their business in my Facebook group because I just think that they are killing it on social media. And it really, like, unites people. I talked about that. I feel like there's a whole community of people who, like, love Apothic, and they were really smart. They started with just two, red and white. And once they got their, you know, customers, now they've added in, you know, a bunch of different varieties. And, you know, everybody knows their favorite one as soon as you mention it.
That's so funny. Cool. I love, and that's one another thing that Kate and I love to talk about is, like, branding and things like that. And, you know, I love that you say it's like a social media thing and, like, how do we create that in our own businesses? But I know that's not the topic today. So why don't we start talking about diversifying your practice and scaling your private practice for multiple income streams?
I know you guys are talking about the about the increased income and revenue and all of that with having multiple revenue streams, which is great. And that's so important. And looking at it from another perspective, I just want to add that it's something that can keep your passion alive too, because when we're just doing one thing, we're doing one thing all day long, it can get monotonous. Even as a therapist, that you're hearing different stories and meeting different people and looking at each case with a fresh set of eyes, when you're doing the same thing over and over for years after years, it really can become a little dull. And so to be able to have multiple income streams and to diversify your practice, it also very much keeps that passion alive. I know it has for myself, and that's been a big drive that's inspired me to want to do that personally. So I'm sure people can relate to that as well.
For sure.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, I think that sometimes we feel a little bad about it. You know, I think that we feel bad sometimes because we are having those feelings where we're like, this is a little boring, or, you know, this is not, you know, engaging me the way it used to. And I think that people think they have to like start from scratch in another area, and that's not necessary. There's, you know, easier ways to add in different projects or different income streams and different things that you can do without kind of quitting everything.
Yeah. So what do you recommend first?
Well, first I do recommend actually like having a stable income stream, because I think that, you know, it can take time to add in other income streams, and it's not always profitable at first. So you want to be able to invest in them. You want to be able to have the time to invest. So make sure that you do know where at least like 50% of your income is coming from. So if that's one-to-one clients, or, you know, your practice at first, that's totally fine. You know, just have that solid income foundation up. Because it does take a lot of attention and it does take a lot of energy to add in different income streams. So you want to make sure that you do have some of that stability first.
That's a good point. Katie and I are doers. It's so funny because we'll be like, oh, we've got this awesome idea. Let's build this online course, or let's add this new service or product or whatever. And yeah, we can knock that out in like a month or two. No biggie. And you know, it always takes like way longer. We underestimate all the time about how long it's going to take to build something. And then once you market it and all of that. So, you know, when you step into a new area,
right,
definitely takes a lot longer than anticipated. So that's a really good point you bring up.
Yeah. And I really do think if you can start out thinking about, you know, this is my current audience, what is something that's like parallel, or, you know, how can I, you know, target them differently? How can I, you know, what else can I create that's going to serve this audience that I'm already an expert in and know?
How can you leverage that?
Right? Yeah, for sure. And one of the things that I see, right? So in private practice, it's trading hours for dollars. We're usually seeing like one-on-one unless we're doing group counseling, which is great. But with moving into multiple streams of income and some of the stuff that we were talking about, like e-courses, products, and things like that, is you can reach the entire world, right? So the opportunity there to really scale your business is way greater. Of course, like Kate said, it does take a lot of work. And I'll tell you, going from a face-to-face business, a local business, to an online business, it's a whole nother animal, guys. Like I shouldn't even say anything, because I wouldn't even know where to start, because there's so much. You know, there's the tech side of things. There's the learning how to advertise, whether it's on Facebook or other places. It's all funnels and things like that, and nurturing relationships. It's a whole different thing. And I know a lot now, when Kate and I got into private practice, I don't think many people were running like AdWords and stuff like that. And SEO was like, what's that? But nowadays, I think people are starting to move more towards those nurturing relationships and funnels, or they're becoming aware of it more, when, of course, that was just not even in our language when we started.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I do think that people kind of just, you know, when you have the practice, people find you because you're local. You know what I mean? Like, there's an easier opportunity to know how to get in front of your audience, because it does have to be local typically, you know, when you're starting your private practice in person.
So why don't you share with Startup Nation some ideas on how do you take your current business and leverage that to create other streams of income?
Well, I think it's really thinking about, you know, what are your current assets in your business? You know, do you have an email list? You know, who's your audience? Are you specialized? Because I do think that when you are going out into the whole world, you need to be much more targeted and specialized, because people aren't just calling you because they saw you on Psychology Today or you have good SEO. So you do need to know who your market is, and you need to be more of a problem solver. You do need to know like what problems they have and what solutions that you want to give them. There has to be, you know, you have to be able to identify a need.
Mm-hmm. So can you give us maybe like an example, like, you know, Sally Smith, private practitioner, she specializes in X, and what might be some of the ways that she could diversify her income?
Yeah. So, I'm trying to think of actually like a client example.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
Yeah, no problem. So yeah, one of my clients actually, she had a local counseling practice, and she started adding in like workshops. So she teamed up with someone in the area in a different business, and started doing like local workshops and things like that. So the audience is still similar, you know, the audience is still women suffering with depression and anxiety, and it's still a local service. So she's able to team up with people for referrals, you know, still use her referral sources and things like that and the relationships that she's built up, but add in, you know, full day workshops.
Very good. Cool. Tell us a little bit more about, as we go through scaling, you know, our private practice and generating multiple income streams, what else is important to know?
You know, you do need to have an audience. I think that people don't understand the numbers a lot of times in terms of like how many people you need on your mailing list to really make a profit, and even just like conversion rates and sales rates. Like people think, oh, let me just put up a course. Let me create a course. Let me turn this into a course. You know, I heard this question recently, like, you know, a therapist had created a group program. So she then wanted to package and sell the group program herself to other therapists, but she has no audience of other therapists. So, you know, it's like, first, is that even a need? Like, it seems like it's good and easy to do because you already have the information. But before you package it up, you really want to like pre-sell it, you know, before you go through that work of like packaging it up and turning it into a product. It's actually better to survey people and even pre-sell it, throw up a page, you know, and let people know it'll be coming out in a month and actually make some money first.
Yeah, we're huge fans of Jeff Walker's launch, and he's got a whole strategy for like the pre-launch, the pre-launch, the launch, the post-launch. It's a big comprehensive process, and people often do think, oh, this is great, I can package this online course and I'll start selling it, and they don't realize what you're talking about is so important to be able to assess the need, to be able to have that target market already there, that you're nurturing the relationship so that they know, like, and trust you before you just automatically start trying to sell stuff to them. Right.
And also, like, you know, I think like making that assumption of, you know, this is something that people want.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting. And I think about our own journey through, so Kate and I, our product is customizable attorney approved private practice paperwork. Right. Mm-hmm. And so when we knew when we created it, it was a need, and we spent months perfecting it, working with healthcare law attorney and things like that. And when we first decided to market it, it was kind of like, throw in an email, here it is, buy it. And it was like, this is so great. And we're like, no, crickets, not. And we're like racking our brain. Like, we know this, we know therapists need this because our story is very similar to other therapists' story. And it was like so frustrating. And then was it this year? I think the beginning of this year, like that's where we like dove into Jeff Walker's launch and Russell Brunson and stuff like that. And then we realized like how you actually do a proper launch and sell. And so we went from, you know, selling paperwork here and there to both of our, what we do now is we do, you know, an hour webinar where we talk about the paperwork and we teach them. Right. So we look at, you know, the consent, we look at technology assisted consent counseling, and then we also look at minor consent. And so we've been able to go from not knowing what the heck we're doing to actually our webinars and our sales from the webinars generate $10,000 each time. Right. And so that's the way you scale and grow a business, but you really need to educate and train yourself on the exact system and process. Yeah. And one of my rules of thumb when I'm talking to, whether it's a potential coachee or other clinicians, if we can help them, great. Cause Kate and I specialize in certain areas, and other areas we don't, and that's okay. And I always say, find the guru or find someone who has a really clear system to gain results, and then educate yourself on that. It's just so important, because I know there's things that we're talking about here today, like, oh, well, pre-sell, throw up a landing page, and that makes sense to us, but it might not make sense to someone else. Like, well, what is that? So, okay, well, I'll do that. And I remember when I tried to do Facebook ads for my private practice, it was like, oh, boost a post. Okay, I could do that. Okay, put boost. All right, that's good. Dollars. Okay, right. That sounds good. Where's the clients? You know, and it's like, yeah. Oh, it doesn't work that way.
Yeah, you really do want to have a strategy. It's not just adding in income streams. And I do see this. I see that people get panicky. They have started their business. They have maybe a handful of clients, and they're immediately like, I want another income stream. And it's like, you really need to build up the first income stream so that you're being profitable, because you can't split your attention too many ways in the beginning without really making sure you have profits.
For sure. And I know one of the things that you're talking about, like with the pre-sale, also like testing and measuring is really important. Like you're talking, mm-hmm. like assure that your audience has a problem that you have a need to fill. And so one of the ways to test and measure, of course, is surveying the audience. Another way is to do either like a one-on-one trial or group coaching, or beta testing, or as you're mm-hmm. offering your e-course, is offer it for free or really low cost. I know Laura Long, who's actually doing a podcast with us talking about profit first. She does a great job beta testing stuff, right? And then until it's really clear and simplified and the audience is really responding to it, then you move to the next phase.
I think webinars are great ideas too, because if you do have this idea for a product, you know, or different program or workshop or whatever, you know, doing webinars or doing something for free and building up that audience is really helpful, because you're actually like pre-validating by having a webinar and seeing a lot of people opt in for it, because then you know that, you know, if you're having that webinar on a specific topic, then you know there's interest there. And that's actually how I got started with my first course, which was about affiliate income. People kept saying like, oh, you need to do something about this. I'm like, why? Like, I didn't see it. So also listen to what other people are asking you for. It sounds like that's what you guys did with your paperwork, is probably that people were like, you know, how'd you get your paperwork? Or, you know, we need paperwork like this. We have this need. So, you know, people kept telling me to do that. So I was like, oh, let me just do a quick free training on it. And I ended up having like 300 people sign up. So Then I was like, oh, there really is a need here, you know? And Sometimes it's in topics that we wouldn't even think, like, but by listening to what people were saying, listening to the audience and testing it, I had, you know, a much more successful launch with that one than I did when I just kind of created something in my own head and was like, oh, people need this.
Right. And it's important to know who your client or customer is, right? So in with private practitioners, when we look at like maybe the world of addiction, right? Most often it's not the addict always looking, it's usually the family member, right? Mm-hmm. The worried, concerned family member. And so how do we market to them specifically? Because they're the one that's going to drive, you know, the referral and then income and things like that. And so, you know, who is your market and knowing what their need is and how you can be of help to them. So cool. Good stuff. So I just kind of maybe want to like just review and highlight some of the things that we've kind of chatted about. So one thing, principle that you share is essential is have an income foundation first, right? So don't try to, you know, divide your attention in too many places. Right. So if you're new in private practice and you're establishing your private practice, great. Maybe you're really just trying to secure your foundation of private practice, but keeping in mind your long-term vision or your long-term goal of diversifying income and working on that slowly, but you don't want to spread yourself too thin. I know you talked about also assuring that you have an audience, number one, and identifying their problems, and assure that what you have is a need that you can fill that would help their problem. And then of course, we're talking about, you know, creating and testing different courses or a workshop by either, you know, pre-selling things or doing a beta test or launch and seeing what happens there, and then kind of going from there. And then of course it's always identifying the platform and really educating yourself around that platform and the system that's actually going to generate, you know, clients coming in, interest and stuff from there. Did I miss anything?
No, I think that's awesome. And I think that it really is, you know, by having that income foundation first, it also gives you the opportunity to outsource. So you can absolutely scale a little quicker that way when you have that secure income foundation, because you can pay people to outsource some of your tasks that don't require you. And then that opens up your time to do more, you know, income generating.
That's yes, one of our favorite words.
Outsourcing tech stuff is my favorite thing to do, because although I can do it and I can figure it out, it just makes me want to pull my hair out, and is certainly not something I'm passionate about. So we love outsourcing.
I always say, thank goodness I'm lazy. That's really why I've been able to scale more quickly, because I just don't want to learn stuff that I don't want to learn. So I don't even bother trying. I'm just like, who can do this for me? Let's get it out there. So, you know, not that I always advise being lazy or not doing or not learning things, but I do think that I see a lot of people bottleneck themselves because they think they have to figure out everything themselves.
Where are your favorite places that you like to find people to outsource things to?
I find my best people by asking my friends who have businesses. So, you know, they're pre-screened, and I can tell you, like, when I find someone good, like, I get them booked out pretty quickly because I tell everyone about them. So I really do think, like, start out by asking, you know, in your networks who people are using. And then of course there's always things like Upwork and Fiverr and things like that. And I do recommend, if you're going to go through there, to have kind of little projects to test out. So you can hire like 3 people for a small project and see what's the best, who gets you the best results and who you work with the best, and then move forward with that person for longer projects.
So I know we've talked about a lot of different things here about increasing income streams, which is great. What do you want our listeners to take away from your message today?
I just want them to take away that, you know, everybody can have multiple income streams, and you want to be preparing yourself. It's a long-term strategy. It's not an instant strategy. And I think that's the thing, is I think that a lot of us think it's instant and then get discouraged when it doesn't work out the first time. So just keep trying and like keep sticking it out and listen to what people are asking you for. Listen to where, you know, pay attention to your gut with where there's a need, and then start doing some serious questioning about it.
And I would just add is get help, support, coaching, and mentoring. And if you have to pay for it because you want to make it successful, then do that. And, or if you're not ready at that point, is save up for that. I think that's one of the things that was a huge issue coming into private practice is, number one, I didn't even have a marketing plan or a savings plan. I just had no plan, right? But, you know, going back is have a savings plan or have money to put towards marketing costs, to put towards coaching or mentoring, because that's going to help you scale up way faster than, you know, just trying to figure it out on your own. Because that is, it's frustrating, it's discouraging, it's disappointing. So, you know, that would be my bit of advice. And I think I say that like all the time.
I do too. And I actually, you know, when I started my private practice, I did hire someone first to tell me what to do, because I was like, I'll just be sitting on the couch Googling forever.
I love your quote. It's good that I'm lazy. I like that.
I always thought it was a problem, but it's helped me out a lot.
Maybe you need to give me some tips and teach me how to be more lazy.
It's like, just find good people to do this stuff that you don't want to learn. And, you know, pay, invest in yourself and invest in shortcuts for sure. Because even though it's scary, I think to make that investment initially, it pays off more in the long run.
For sure.
It's interesting. I like to do my fitness videos off YouTube, and I was going on YouTube, you know, I always have the commercials and stuff like that. And Dean Grazio, I think that's his last name, he's in real estate, but he was talking about how he achieves goals and stuff like that. And one of the things he said is, don't focus on your weaknesses, only your strengths. Right. And I think coming in a private practice, a lot of times we think we have to know how to do websites and SEO and outsource, delegate that stuff, guys. I can't tell you enough. If you don't know it, you're not a specialist in it. And even if you are, if you don't enjoy it, just have someone else do it. Well, anyways, Nicole, you have been a pleasure to chat with. We're excited about your topic. And next week, so I'm excited, like, thinking about this, because this year, one of the books that we had read was the book called Profit First. And it really made our business profitable this year, but also really assuring that we're kind of putting money in the right places. Kate and I get bonus checks now.
I love bonus time.
And consistent salary. So we are just having a candid conversation with our friends, Ernesto Segues Mundo and Laura Long, about Profit First. We've all read the book and started implementing it this year in our business. So next week, you guys are going to listen to us chat about Profit First. So you're definitely not going to want to miss that, because if you really want to scale your business in the way of making it profitable, well, everyone really should listen to it.
Yeah, 100%. 100%. It totally transforms your whole perspective on the financial side of private practice.
Yep.
Really cool.
Yes, I'm a Profit First fan too, for sure.
Ah, woo, woo, woo. Such a great book. Love. You know, it's funny, in the Profit First book, Michael, I can't remember his last name, but we interviewed Michelle Villalobos, who's a branding expert. And Michael is actually friends with Michelle Villalobos.
Oh,
and
really?
In the book, he references how he went to his friend's house, Michelle Villalobos. And I was like, I don't think I've ever read a book where someone references someone that I know. So that was really cool. But anyway, Startup Nation, you're going to want to join us next week. We thank you for joining us today. So check out the show notes for all the resources, tips, suggestions, advice, and all that stuff. And Nicole, how can people get in contact with you?
They can find me at NicoleLiloia.com, and they can absolutely grab that multiple income streams sheet. I have a special one for them with 10 income streams that they can add right in. And I think that will be really helpful to get them started.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And we look forward to connecting with you in the future. And Startup Nation, thanks for letting us inspire you from startup to mastery.
See you later, guys.